Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Blessings and glory and honor, they all belong to Him. No one else, they belong to Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Can you turn with me to Exodus, the 14th chapter, starting at the 10th verse? You are there. Can we all stand for the reading of God's word to honor Him? All those who can stand. Bless you. And when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptian marched after them. So they were very afraid, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. Then they said to Moses, "Because there were no graves in Egypt, you have taken us away to die in the wilderness. Why have you so dealt with us to bring us up out of Egypt? Is this not the word we told you in Egypt, saying, 'Let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians'? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die in the wilderness." And Moses said to the people, "Don't be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which He will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians who you see today, you will see again no more forever. The Lord will fight for you. You shall hold."
19, fall on me, anointing, fall on me. Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall on me. Anointing, fall on me. Anointing, fall on me. Fall on me. Let the power of the Holy Ghost fall on me. Anointing, fall on me.
Hallelujah. I give honor to God, my Father, my Creator, to Jesus, my Savior, and my Lord, to the Holy Spirit that leads and guides me in all truth and always let me know what the Father wants. I give honor to my pastor, the Reverend Dr. Stephanie Stratford, a leader, a mentor, a warrior like David, who's not afraid of any giant, a prayer warrior like Daniel, bold enough to pray in your face, a teacher like Jesus, a master of her craft, tenacious like Paul, no time for nonsense. You guys remember John Mark? Sit him back, ain't got time for him. A wife, a mother, a grandmother, and a friend to her friends. To her husband, I honor you, Deacon Stratford, first gentleman. To all the pastors and leaders and friends, and to the children of the Most High God. And last but not least, to my family, my daughter, and my grandbabies, my four grandbabies. Love them so much. I have a question to ask, and I'll read the scripture again. And when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them. So they were very afraid. The children of Israel cried out to the Lord. Then they said to Moses, "Because there were no graves in Egypt, you have taken us away to die in the wilderness. Why have you dealt with us to bring us out of Egypt? Is there not the word we told you in Egypt, saying, 'Let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians'? For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said to the people, don't be afraid. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians you will see today, you will not see anymore forever. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. So my question is, what does it take for you to believe? What does it take for you to believe? I believe it takes death, humility, and commitment. And we'll get into this later. In this chapter, Pharaoh had just left the people go after the death angel came and destroyed their firstborn. So all the children of Israel were leaving, and they were going towards the place that God was taking them. And the children of Israel were traveling forward, and God told Moses to tell them to turn around and go back and camp at this town between the sea and Migdol. Okay? So say set up. God wanted Pharaoh to think that the children of Israel were confused, that they were trapped in the wilderness and they just didn't know where they needed to go. So God hardened Pharaoh's heart so that he would chase after the children of Israel. Say set up. Okay, so we see here that when the children of Israel were walking back, they saw Pharaoh coming and they panicked. They got afraid and they started talking to the Lord or crying out to the Lord, and they went to Moses and said, why did you do this again? But God had a plan in store. Okay? God wanted everyone to know, especially Moses knew. And what I don't understand, but I do understand, God had just did all these great wonders in Egypt. He had just did everything, and the children of Israel saw that. But yet, when they saw Pharaoh coming, they forgot. And they told Moses, why did you bring us out here to die? Okay, so when you see your enemy coming before you, just try to remember what he did before, okay? But we know because of situation, things cause you not to believe. So what does it take for you to believe? Okay, here we have the children of Israel who have seen all the great God's wonders and know what God did in Egypt and killed the firstborn, but yet they asked Moses, why did you bring us out here to die? And again, a great wonder is about to happen. So God, in his gracious and his merciful character, who he is, all right, he tell Moses, all right, what do you see? What do you have in your hand? I'm going to hold back the army. Just stretch out your rod, and the sea is going to open, and he's going to let them die. So the children of Israel saw them die in the Red Sea. Okay, now how did they get into bondage? Let's go back. Abraham was called by God back in Genesis 12. He was called by God to a country that he did not know. So God told him that I will give you a land. I promise to make you a great nation. I promise to make your name great. You will be a blessed man, and I will make you a blessing. And out of all the people that God chose, he chose Abraham. And I believe he chose Abraham because he knew he could trust Abraham, even before Abraham knew he could be trusted. So God chose Abraham, and Abraham was a good man, you know, except for when he, you know, kind of pimped Sarah. But he was afraid. That's why he was afraid. He was afraid. He was afraid. I feel for Abraham. Your life on the line, you got to do something desperate. You know, and then, of course, you know, when Abraham was, you know, really happy to see Hagar, you know, but he was forced to do it. You know, if he didn't do it, she was going to hit him with the frying pan. You know, just being a man. But Abraham was a good man. He was a good man. So God trusted him, and God knew he would carry out his plan. So God can do the same thing with us, no matter where you come from, no matter what your past is or was. God can use you. All he needs is your willingness to just go. That's all he needs, your willingness to go. So Abraham left his home And he took Lot. He wasn't supposed to, but he did. Again, it was probably a man thing. You know, I got my wife here, but, you know, I need a brother with me to support me. So he took Lot, you know, because he was familiar with him, and I understood that. But he wasn't supposed to. But later on, they separated. Lot went to Solomon, Gomorrah, and the city was destroyed because of sin. And then the story goes on, and God promised Abram children. But Sarah could not wait. So here comes Ishmael, the I can't wait baby. I can't wait. How many of you got an I can't wait situation going on? You got to wait on him. So, but God is gracious and merciful, and he blessed Abraham with the promise, and he blessed Hagar with the promise. And so Abram goes on, and God blessed Sarah with Isaac at the age of 99. So we have Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph. But I wanted to tell you, before Abraham had the baby, God told Abraham in a dream, and it was kind of a bad dream, that the nation would be in slavery for 400 years. And it's Genesis 15 and 13. God told Abraham in a dream that his descendants would be strangers in the land, and they would be afflicted. So God already let him know what was going to happen. Okay, so here we have Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, and Joseph was one of 12 brothers and a sister, and no one talks about the sister that much, but he had a sister, okay? And the brothers were jealous, you know, of Abraham because of his father. Joseph was really a love child, you know, his father loved Rachel, who was his mother, and so Joseph knew this, and he kind of, you know, when you're liked, you know, you kind of boast yourself up and, you know, you tease. So he teased his brothers, and his brothers got angry, you know, and wanted to kill him. But, you know, the oldest said, no, let's not kill him. Let's just put him away so that he could live, and we just sell him, you know, to the first group of people to come by. And that's what happened. So Joseph went to Egypt. Here we go. Here we're going to Egypt. God's prophecy is coming through. Joseph went to Egypt, and God was with Joseph because God knew what he had to do in Joseph in order to bring everybody into Egypt, even though he wasn't supposed to go there. You can see how the detour happened with, you know, Isaac, you know, favoring Rachel, and Joseph being, you know, teasing his brothers, and we hate you, and all these emotions going on, and you are detouring from God's plan. But God knew it way back in Genesis 15 that this would happen. So Joseph went to Egypt. He had favor from God. You know, he was in the house of this chief servant and did well and, you know, interpret dreams, and finally came into a place of second command. All right? And when he came in second command, God showed him a dream that gave him favor. He interpreted the Pharaoh's dream, and there was a famine in the land. So with that famine in the land, people started coming to Egypt because they heard that they had food. So that's how Joseph's family came down into Egypt, because they heard. So Joseph's family came down. They lived in Goshen, a small community that was next to Egypt. Now, when Joseph was dying, he told his brethren that God will surely visit you. Here's another prophecy. And bring you out of this land to the land which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob to carry. And he told them to carry my bones with you. Don't leave me here. I may not be alive when you go, but take me while I'm dead. Don't leave me in Egypt. You know, this is not the land that God promised us. So I'm glad that God reminded Joseph that this is not the place we're going to settle. Okay, we're just passing through. So Joseph told him that and reminded all his brothers, just don't leave me here even if I'm dead. So the story goes on, and they did just that. Can you turn with me to Numbers 14 and 11? And I'm reading from the New King James Version. Then the Lord said to Moses, how long will these people reject me? And how long will they not believe me with all the signs which I have performed among them? And I ask you the question, what would it take for you to believe? What would it take for you to believe? In this chapter here, God told Moses to send out the spies, send out 12 spies and spy out the land, okay? And so they did. 12 went, 12 came back. But there were 10 that had a bad report. Okay? And but the report was true. It may have been bad, but it was true. But they were going by what they saw. Then you had the other two who had a good report, and their report was true also, but it was good. Why? Because they remembered what God did in Egypt. Okay? So they were going by faith that God can, we can go in here and take the land. Okay? So the people, and God said this in his word, that they'd rather believe a lie. And that wasn't a lie, but it was like, you know, it was doubt. You know, you don't believe God can do that. They'd rather believe a negative report than a good report. So the people began to just fuss and cry out, and all night, you know, they complaining about having to go into this land with all these giants. All they can see is the giant. What are you seeing? What are you seeing? Do you see the giant? Do you see the giant? Do you see the big grapes? Or do you see the milk and the honey? What do you see? Hallelujah. What are you seeing? My God, my God. So, you know, they complain, and God is saying then, you know, how long? How long will these people reject me? How long will they not believe me with all the signs which I have performed among them? So Joseph and Caleb gave a good report by faith based on what God had done, and the people didn't like it. And I know I'm telling a story real quick. I know when I was a babe in Christ, young in Christ, and there was a bus trip at my old church, and the bus either broke down or got detoured, but there were children on the bus. It was a trip, and the bus was late coming back, and all the parents and, you know, the church people were out there just, you know, fussing and complaining and worrying in front of the church. And I'm thinking, can we just pray and believe God? What are you talking about? You know, what are you saying? That's our child. You don't know what you're talking about. You know, and I just got jumped at, and I said, oh, man. You know, so I didn't know what to do. And then the next day, that was a Saturday night, that Sunday, a young lady came to me and said, I heard what you said. It's okay. You know, you said the right thing, so it's okay, you know. And I said, wow. You know, so they're complaining, you know, knowing God but complaining. Saw what God, know what God can do but complaining. Same as the children of Israel, seeing God open. And this is just after the Red Sea. Now, the Red Sea was after the wonders in Egypt. But this is after the Red Sea. You saw the sea open and you walked. You walked through it. And then you saw the water come down and drown all the soldiers. And you're going to talk about these giants? Oh, my goodness. What is that to God? What is that to God? There will always be a remnant that will believe God. And he will use the remnant. And that remnant with Jacob and Caleb. I mean, Jacob and Joshua. I'm sorry, Joseph and Caleb. He will always use a remnant. As big as any church is, it's always a remnant that God is looking at and answering their prayers because they believe God. It's never in the numbers, you know. It's in that heartfelt belief. And that God looks at. Amen? I mean, he wants us to be unified. And Pastor talked about it this morning. And, you know, when the church is unified, you know, you can do power and wonders. But believe me, if the church don't get unified, he's going to use the remnant. Because there can always be a remnant. Hallelujah. Amen. So what are you looking at? What are you looking at? Are you looking at the grapes, the honey, you know, the milk? Or are you looking at the giant? And that's what's stopping you from believing. Are you looking at the giants? Okay, so where are you right now? Where are you facing? What do you want from God? What do you believe in God for? He knows what you're looking for, and he knows what it takes to help you to believe. John 10:37. We can go to there real quick, and while you're turning, one more scenario about our brothers and sisters of the faith not believing God. This is Jesus talking. He said, if I do not the works of my Father, do not believe me. John 10:37. But if I do, though you do not believe me, believe the works, that you may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. Jesus was telling the Pharisees, he's talking to the Pharisees right here, you don't have to believe on me. this man who you think is just like you. Just believe the works. You've seen the blind see, and you heard about the ears being opened, the devils being cast out of people. Just believe the works, okay? So Jesus also told him that I and my Father are one. And this is one of the main reasons why, in this chapter, why they wanted to stone him. He also said that ye are gods, and they really wanted to stone him on that. But his word, amen. So, of course, you know, he said other things and they did not like, but the truth was that he asked, why are you stoning me? Don't stone me. Why are you stoning me? You're stoning me just for the works. But it's not the works. It's because you call yourself a God. But they didn't understand. So Jesus tried to tell them again, my works speak for me. I don't even have to say anything. Just go and look at all the witnesses. They've come to you and you try to shut them up. One man said that, look, I don't know. I know that I was blind and now I can see. So don't, you know, I don't know how he did it, but he did it. You knew me from birth. They got his mother. His mother, is this your son? Yes, it's my son, but he's older to speak for himself. Speak to him. And he said, look, I can see. I can see. So Jesus said, believe the works. What would it take? We got the word. We got witnesses. We got things in our lives that God has done that we know nobody else could do it. What would it take for you to believe? What would it take? Hallelujah. God has proven that he is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that you may ask or think. What have you heard? What have you seen to help you to believe? Jesus did miracles right in front of their faces. God used Moses and did great wonders right in front of their faces. And they believed at that moment until the next challenge came. So do we believe from challenge to challenge, from situation to situation? Do we have a seesaw belief system going on? What is belief? In Strong Concordance, it says that it's to be firm, to endure, to be faithful, to be true, stand fast and trust. So belief is something that takes action or thought process, some type of movement or mindset. Dictionary.com says that belief is something that you believe, an opinion or a conviction, confidence, faith, and trust. Remember I said that it takes death, humility, and commitment to believe. Those are my, that I believe, and I'm pretty sure there's many other reasons that people can give you why they think what it takes to believe. So let's look at death. 1 Corinthians 15:31. And we know that death means to die. And Paul is telling the Corinthians church, I affirm, verse 31, by the boasting in you, which I have in Christ Jesus, our Lord, I die daily. I die daily. I have to die daily. I have to crucify myself daily. I have to work at this. Okay? You have to die to your senses, your emotions, your intellect, your faithless experience. Not your faithful experience, but your faithless, the ones that didn't work. You got to die to those because they're going to bring you back those negative remembrances. You don't want that. You have to die to these things because they feed into your doubt and they feed into your unbelief. And that's what you don't want to do. So that's what you got to die to. Die to your philosophy and your wisdom, man's way of doing things. God has taken the foolishness of the world and confounded it. And he used his word to do that. But the wisdom of man is foolishness unto God. So it can never compare. Never. You got to die to those things. And especially your experiences. You have an experience that did something to you that showed you proof that this thing don't work. Well, weigh it out. Is it negative or is it positive? Does it prove God or disprove God? It won't disprove God, it disprove you. Because God is always faithful in what he does. And if he allows that to happen, it's for a reason. Just examine, but die to those things that stop pushing you away from God, that push you into the realm of unbelief and doubt. Okay? If you say, I believe God, no matter what the situation tells me, say, I believe God. You have three words. I believe God. 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 I don't care. No, I believe God. Who are you talking to? You're talking to yourself. You're talking to your mind. You're talking to your heart. I believe God. God, I believe you. Yes, I do. I don't care. I believe you, God. I believe you, oh God. Death also means to give up. Life gives up when death comes in. So what do you have to give up? Your will. You have to surrender all your thoughts and actions and experiences to believe God, especially when they're negative. They counteract God. They counteract the things that he wants to do for you. Flesh and blood just cannot inherit this thing. It's a spiritual thing. And even though you cannot see, you see the results of what you do, but you don't see where it starts. It starts in the mind. It starts in the hearts. It starts in these thoughts. We hear thoughts. We know. I know you hear thoughts. I know you say, something told me. That's something. You know, and that something is pulling you away from believing God, or it's pushing you towards God, which is the Holy Spirit. We call the Holy Spirit something because we haven't, like, quite identified it yet. But, you know, if it's good, then it was the Spirit of God. You can tag it at the end. You can tag it at the end. What am I saying? Surrender to the word of the Lord. Surrender to his testimony. We have his word here to demonstrate to us what he has done. His word is God. God is speaking to us through his word. And if you can't read, God, you can pray. God, I need to know what you're saying. Help me, oh God. You can talk to God. Because we do have people who are blind and cannot see. How do they relate to God? They pray. And of course, they have Braille too, but they pray. They pray to God. So there's avenues of communication to God that will help him to surrender those things that are bothering you, those things that keep you into a negative mode. Okay? Surrender to the word of God. Surrender to the testimony you heard about God through healing and witnessing. We know that God has many people he has healed. You've healed on your job, you're healed at home, in your neighborhood, your community. He's even healed you. Surrender to that, meaning I'm going to believe it, and I'm going to stay with that. I'm not going to surrender to what the doctor said and, you know, how I feel in my body. He did it for her. He did it for him. I know he would do it. Surrender to that. And work with that, and work with that. Surrender means giving up those negative thoughts, and believing God that he will do it for you, surrendering so that you can believe, so you can move forward. Hallelujah. Surrender to the experience that take you out of the but. Surrender to what you know. Don't surrender to I know, but. But what do you know? What do you know? Can you walk in that no? What do you know that God has done for you? Can you take that one thing and make yourself walk in it? Make yourself walk in it. It's a work that we have to do. This flesh does not want to do anything to please God. It's happy where it is, wherever you are. It loves it. It loves the earth. It loves the things that appeals to it. Why? Because the enemy set it up that way. He set it up that way. He knows what you like, because he was there from the beginning when you were born. So he heard that, you know, you like green and you like yellow, or you like all these different things. And every one of us have a demon assigned to us to make sure some of those things come to pass. And we also have angels assigned to us, you know, to fight our battles from the demons. But he knows. So it's a setup for us. But you can work against it. God has given you all things to fight against the enemy. To fight against the enemy. But the enemy uses our experiences, our emotions, those things that cause us to just kind of give in to it. To give in to it. You know, this walk is a fight. It really is a fight. And you got to see the big picture. You got to see heaven. Okay? That's the big picture. You got to see heaven. You got to know that you're not going to live here forever. You got to know that if I die today or tomorrow, where am I going to go? You got to know that heaven and hell is real. And that's the big picture there. That's what you strive for, to get to not have your soul man burn forever or to live with God forever. So that's the big picture. That's what you got to fight for. But you got to see it in order to walk in it. Your greatest CEOs see the biggest picture. He saw the big picture. Most of your big corporations can see when they're developing it where it's going to go. Where it's going to go. And they fight and they work at it to the end. And then they rest in it. Okay, so you got to fight. My second suggestion is humility. You have to be humble. And it takes humility to believe. It really does. Isaiah 57:14-15 says, "And one shall say, heap it up, prepare the way. Take the stumbling blocks out of the way of my people. But thus says the high and lofty one, who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in a high and holy place with him who has a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite one." James 4:6 says, "But he gives more grace, therefore he says, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble." The New Living Translation said he gives favor to the humble. So it's a good thing to be humble. You get favor from God. James 4:10 says, "Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up." Being humble to God says, "Not my will, your will be done." It says, "Not my way, but your way, O God." You have to surrender all. And it's a fight. I'm telling you, your will does not want to do the will of God. But you got to bring it down and tell it, "You will. You will, because I want to be successful. I want to have the abundance that God has for me. I don't want my life to be a yo-yo, up and down, high today, low tomorrow, and just all these things. But all I do is believe God. That's all he asked me to do, is believe him." So emotions, you know, get yourself together. We're going to believe God. We're going to take this to another level. We are going to believe God. I surrender, God. And you know what Pastor talked about, the power of strength? The Holy Spirit will strengthen you to fight you. Woo! Yes, he will. Oh, my goodness. He will strengthen you to fight you, because you are who's stopping you to get forward, move forward. Unless someone has a gun in your head or really trying to make you do something, it's just us that's stopping us from moving forward. Humble is used most times in a verb, to make low. So it's something, like I said, that we have to do. Being humble does not make you weak, okay? But it shows your strength and it shows self-control. And the third one, it takes commitment. It takes commitment to believe, because, you know, God is giving us a measure of faith. I mean, his spirit is in us, and no, we are just like him. That's why Jesus said we are little gods, because we're like our father. If you take off this earth suit, we look just like God. Okay? So faith is in us, but it's a measure of it. But God, because he's such a gentleman, he won't force himself. So you got to say, "I believe you, God." So you got to increase that faith. And the first way you start doing it is by believing. It's by believing. The faith is there. Okay? But you got to commit what? Your way. Psalm 37:5 says, "Commit your way to the Lord. Trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass." Proverbs 3:5-6 says, "Your heart." You got to commit your heart. He won't break it, guys. I promise you. God will not break your heart. God would not commit your heart to him. I'm telling you, he won't break it. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not unto your understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. You commit your way, commit your heart, commit your hope. Jeremiah 17, 7 and 8 says, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is in the Lord. For he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river. And he will not fear when he comes, but its leaf shall be green. And he will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will he cease from yielding fruit. And you can also find part of this in Psalms 1. He that meditated on the Lord both day and night shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters. If you yield your hope into him, he will make you flourish. He will make sure you never see drought according to him, not according to man. Because you may be empty, but you're full according to God. Put your hope in him. Put your hope. Commit your way unto the Lord. So when we die and we be humble and we commit ourselves, you start to believe. You start to get it. Okay, I got this. But what do you get? You get freedom. Galatians 3:22. But the scriptures declare that we all are prisoners of sin. So we receive God's promise of freedom only by believing in Jesus Christ. What else do you get? You get salvation. Mark 16:16. He who believes and is baptized will be saved. But he that does not believe shall be condemned. What else do you get when you believe? You become a son of God. John 1:12 says, but as many as receive him, to them gave he the right to become children of God, to those who believed in his name. John, the New Translation, New Living Translation said, but to all who believe him and accepted him, he gave them the right to become the children of God. There's many reasons for unbelief. It's just the opposite of believing. Doubt, sin, your experiences. Most time it's our experiences. What we have experienced kind of seared in our mind that, you know, I'm not letting that happen anymore. I can't go any further than this. You know, I know what happened. I saw this and I saw that. No. Mm-mm. God, I believe you, but that's not happening to me no more. Our intellectual understanding, our college politics, you know, the philosophies and Scientology and just knowing what the world has out there, you know, and just souping it up and eating it and reading it, you know, the Star Magazine and Entertainment Tonight and Us, all that filtering in that's pushing you away from believing God. It pushes us away. So when you bring your situation to pass, no, God will bring your situation to pass when you believe him. And while he is doing that, he wants you to rest. Because a lot of times when we believe God for something, it doesn't come right away. So he just wants you to rest in it. So while you believe in him to do it, you believe in him for the rest. He's going to give you peace. God doesn't want you to be traumatic. He doesn't want you to be upset or anxious about something that he's doing for you. He just wants you to totally believe him for all things. Okay, God, I know it's coming, so I'm believing you to calm down. It's coming. I believe you, God. It's all right. It's all right. I know it's coming. So he wants you to be at peace. I just come to encourage you and let you know that God just wants you to believe him. And I ask you, what does it take? Does it take, I believe it takes faith, it takes us to die, and it takes commitment. Jesus said, if thou can just believe it, all things are possible to him that believe, all things. He said all, his all, not the all you can think about, like what does he really mean? He said all, rest on that. He said all things. If I believe. So So this is what God says about you in his word. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Genesis 18, 14, Jeremiah 32 and 17. With men, this is impossible. But with God, all things are possible. And he was talking about a situation, but just say my situation. This situation is impossible for man to do. But with God, all things are possible. For with God, nothing will be impossible. He has given us all things that pertain to life and godliness. Everything you need, according to him, he has it for you. And it's all. He has given us all things. That's a good word to know. All. Especially when God is saying all. Okay? Rest in his all. And God shall supply all your needs. Need. It has no S on it. It's need. Because whatever the need is, he got it. According to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. The Spirit of truth, he will guide you into all truth. Even in your daily walk, the Spirit of truth will guide you. So the word all, God wants you to know that there's no limit according to him. But your responsibility is just to believe. Pastor said, we are the church. Do you believe it? Do you believe that you have power to heal the sick? Do you believe that you can lay hands on yourself and be healed? He's given you the power. But the power is stopped by unbelief. What would it take for you to believe? We got to believe and we won't. We're no different from the children of Israel. The Lord asked the same question again to us. How long would it take for them to believe me? How long would it take for you to believe God? Don't let it be on your sick bed. I told my mom, she was raised in the church, and the church hurt her, and she left out, and I wasn't raised in the church. And she was holding on to it. I mean, she couldn't stand the church. So, I guess my grandma was in me because she was a church lady. So I just wanted to go to church. I would find a church on the corner somewhere and just go there. And I came into the Lord and started, growing in God. And my mom, I would tell my mom all the time, I said, don't come to church on your sick bed. Come while you're walking. Come while you can. Come now. You know God. You know what he can do. Believe him. So God just wants us to believe. You got to fight you. Your life depends on you knowing God and believing God. What does it take for you to believe? I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe, I believe, I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe, I believe, I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe, I believe, I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe, I believe, I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe, I believe, I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe, I believe, I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe. I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe, I believe, I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe, I believe, I believe, Lord, I believe, Lord, I believe. Let it ring all week. Hallelujah. 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 Robert, do you have that? Hallelujah. Amen. We're going to continue with a little bit more of that. Hallelujah. As you prepare your offerings, you can sit and just listen to the words of this song.
See you.